Jesus remains forevermore. Take your Bibles, turn with me to the book of 2 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. We're going to pick it up in verse 17. This morning we're going to begin a new series of teaching. You know, we just finished the Gospel of Mark, not going back there for a while. Appreciated Pastor Jacob filling in last week, got my son moved, everything is looking good. If no one has officially welcomed you, let me welcome you to the computer age. I know that seems a little bit late, maybe, but I just wonder, I know in a congregation this size, some of you are out there and you're going, I don't use a computer. How many of you would say you don't use a computer? Well, let me let you know, you probably do and just don't realize it. The drums this morning were computer orchestrated. This little thing I carry in my pocket, if you have a cell phone of any kind, it's all computerized. If you don't have a cell phone and use a landline, guess what? It goes through a computer system in order to, for people to hear you on the other end. If you go to an ATM, you use a computer. Every time you turn around nowadays, you're using a computer. If you drive an automobile, there's a big computer in that automobile. They say that there's more computing power in this little cell phone that I carry than was in the spaceship that took the men to the moon. Isn't that amazing? It's just unbelievable. But you know, sometimes, if you've done anything at all with computers, sometimes you know they can become what they call infected. They can pick up a virus. They start slowing down and they stop functioning at the level that they're supposed to, that they were created to function at. And so what they tell you to do is reboot it. You know, turn it off, turn it back on. That's what reboot is all about. We're really good as people about rebooting life. We like to start all over again. We like to say, well, I made a mistake, I'm going to start all over again. But the problem is, if we don't deal with that virus that's inside, we still have the problem. You can start it all over again, you can try again, but we're going to find ourselves living again less than we were intended. So we need an upgrade. We need an upgrade. Humanity has been infected with a virus, and that virus has been called sin. But the good news for all of us is that Jesus Christ, God in Christ, has offered us an opportunity to reboot and to upgrade what is inside us. Now, you know, when I upgrade the software inside my computer, you can look at the outside of my black computer and it's still black. It doesn't change the outside. The outside still looks the change or the same to everybody that looks at it. But the inside is where it counts. And the inside is very different. In the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter 5, verse 17, we find some very interesting promises from God. He says that if any man is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, everything is become new. That is a really great promise. That is a really great hope for me and a great hope for you. Because that means that we can have a system upgrade. We just sang about it earlier. There is a better life than the one that most of us live. There is a better life. There is an opportunity for us to live up to the potential that God has created us for. But it may require an upgrade to our internal system. In fact, I will tell you, it will require an upgrade to your internal system. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, or there, hold your Bibles up when you found it. We're going to be looking around. Get your outlines out. All the scripture you're going to need is in your outline as well. Listen to what Paul writes for us. He says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. I love the opportunity that is before us to become new. To let the past be the past. Some of us still live our lives, even though we claim to be followers of Christ, we still live our lives with the shame and the guilt of the past. We still live our lives eaten up on the inside because we feel like we let God down yesterday. And I'm here to tell you that in Christ Jesus, the past is just that. It is gone. There is something new in you. There is a brand new life. There is great promise from God about this new life. There is a great promise from God in this passage. If you got your outlines, the first point is the promise. If anyone is in Christ, He is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. It's time for us to say goodbye to our past mistakes, to say goodbye to our past sins, to say goodbye to our past habits. But I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, preacher, that's hard. I've tried. But it's tough. Here's what we need to understand. We're just laying some foundation here. We're going to be working on this for several weeks. We're going to try to learn what it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ, what it means to become a new creation. Repeat this after me. In Christ, I am a new creation. Say it again. In Christ, I am a new creation. Listen, I don't care what you've done in the past. I don't care what kind of sins you were involved in. It doesn't matter what kind of hurts, habits, and hang-ups you bring to the table. I'm here to tell you that God, in Jesus Christ, has given us all the opportunity to become brand new. The old can go away, and the new can come. First thing that we discover in this passage that we're looking at today is that there is a promise that we can be new creations. But there's a problem. And that's what we have to address. Number two in your outline, the problem is we tend to be resistant to change. How many of you ladies would say your husband's kind of set in his ways? Can I see your hands? And how many of you men would say your husband might be a little set in his, or your wife might be set in her ways? Can I see? Guys, be really careful. My counseling has kind of fallen off recently, and so I'm looking for more counseling to come into the office. There's a big problem. And here's what the problem is. The book of Proverbs identifies it for us. It tells us, for as he thinks in his heart, so is he. The problem that we face is, it's not that we're not committed to change life. The problem is, the inside of us, something has to change about our thinking. We have to start thinking differently. We have to have a software upgrade. And listen, trust me, I've been around some of you, and what's up between your ears, kind of soft. And you guys are going, we've been around you too, Terry, and what's between your ears, a little soft. We need an upgrade of our thinking. We need to change our thinking because we tend to act as we think about ourselves. That's what Proverbs tells us. As a man thinks, so he is. As a woman thinks, so she is. We have to change what we think. We have to change what we think about ourselves, and we have to change what we think about our God. In order for this new creation to begin to emerge and for a new and better life to be lived. In Christ, I am a new creation. My problem is I'm up against a lot of old thinking. We tend to resist change. Let me tell you how it works. When my daughter Ashley was home, I could look at my daughter and I could say, Ashley, you are a beautiful young woman. And I could tell her that every single day. But you know what the truth is? Until she believes it about herself, she will always live in doubt. God can look at me and say, Terry, I love you. I loved you so much that I sent my son Jesus to die on the cross for your sins. He became the lightning rod for all of your sinfulness. He took the full punishment for everything you have done that was bad. Until I believe that in my heart, it will never manifest itself as truth in my life. You see, the problem is we tend to act based on what we believe about ourselves. And so we have to change some of the things that we think and some of the things that we believe. I'm here to tell you, God is not your enemy. He loves you. He wants to forgive you. He wants to be intimately connected to you. But until you believe that about yourself, you will never live life to its full. until you believe that that's true about you and your relationship with God, you will never live life to the full. People act out of who they think they are. Third thing we discover the process. Notice what it says here. Therefore, if anyone, here's the key, in Christ, he is a new creation. That's what we're going to be looking at for the next several weeks. We're going to be looking at what does it mean to be in Christ. I would encourage you to just take your New Testament sometime and just start reading through the letters of Paul and start looking at all the times it talks about being in Christ or being in Him or being in Jesus Christ. Look at all the times that it talks about followers of Christ being found in Him and what that means for us. What that means for the way that we should live our lives. Because until we get rid of the old and start embracing the new, until we change the way we think and start embracing the way God thinks about us, we will continue to live lives of frustration. We will continue to live life less than what God intended. You ever been to church and you felt like the church was a travel agent for a guilt trip? I mean, you go there and they tell you, you want to be a good Christian, you got to pray more, you got to read the Bible more, you got to witness more, you got to do this, and you tried and you tried and you tried, and guess what? It doesn't work. Oh, all that stuff is good. I remember when I was in college, 2959 plan was out. Peter Lord, Titusville, First Baptist Church, 2959. Every follower of Jesus Christ needed to have a 2959 book. You opened it up, you spent 29 minutes and 59 seconds every single day having a quiet time with God. Let me tell you, the first 2 weeks, it was wonderful. And then life kicks in. And it goes from 29:59 to 19:59. And then 9:59. And then some days, it was lucky, when I had a Greek exam coming up, it was lucky to be 59. And I felt guilty about it the whole time. Because we really believe somehow that it's all about what we do instead of what He's done. We think it's about what we can accomplish. You see, the whole process is about being in Christ. The key is being in Christ. In Christ, I am already blessed. It does not matter what the circumstance that surrounds me looks like. It doesn't matter what my physical condition may be. If I'm found in Christ, I am a blessed man. If you are found in Christ, then you are a blessed woman. I've given you two more verses here to prove this. This is what it says, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3. Blessed be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places in Christ. You notice that in Christ phrase? I've been blessed. It doesn't matter what it looks like on the outside. Here's what I've got to embrace on the inside, that in Jesus, I am a blessed man. Maybe I don't have any money in the bank. I am still blessed because I have riches untold. See, we live in a world that bases everything on appearance. But I got to tell you something. Appearance has never held a hurting baby. And appearance has never fed the hungry. No, what we have to do is we must embrace this new idea, this new thinking. We need to begin to think of ourselves and think of our lives as being in Christ. Here's what it said. If any man, if any woman be in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has been done away with and everything has become new. I'm ready for an upgrade. I'm ready for a reboot. I want things to be new with me. But for that to happen, something's got to happen inside me. The outside may look the same to you, but it looks very different to God. Because He looks at my heart. He looks at what's inside. Paul again writes in Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 through 3. He says, if you were then raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God. That's where Christ is. Set your mind on the things above, not on things of the earth. For you died, and your life is hid with Christ in God. That's a blessed place. I don't know if you figured this out, but sitting at the right hand of the Father, it's got to be a place of blessing. That's where Jesus is. And if any man is in Christ, he's sitting at the right hand of the Father. When our kids were little, Betsy and I took them to Disney World. And I don't know how many of you have ever been to Disney World. If you've been to Disney World or Worlds of Fun or some of those places, you know they've got all kinds of roller coasters. And we got on Space Mountain. Anybody ever ridden Space Mountain? Look at the hands. I get on that thing, and we take off, and about halfway through it, I'm going, what in the world am I doing on this thing? And I realize, there's no steering wheel on a roller coaster. I'm going where that roller coaster wants to take me. I'm going to end up, when I end up, where I end up, based on what was already predetermined for the roller coaster. I'm in the roller coaster with no way to change direction. Oh, you got to get this. I am in Christ, which means my life has been set on a new set of rails, and there is no steering wheel for me. I'm going to go where He goes. My destiny is somehow tied to where He ends up. I'm going to take every hill that He takes, go into every dip that He goes into. I will turn right as He turns and go left as He turns left, if I'm truly in Him. But did you get what I said? My destiny is tied to His destiny. I just got through reading. Where is Jesus? He is seated at the right hand of the Father. Guess where I am? I am in Him, seated at the right hand of the Father. Oh, you see me walking around on this earth, but my Heavenly Father sees me in Christ. This is a done deal. Ephesians said, He has blessed me with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places. That's past tense. That's a done deal. I'm not trying to earn my way under the umbrella of His blessing. I abide in Christ under His blessing. I'm not looking for and longing for Him to bless again. He has already blessed me more than I ever deserve. Boy, this is good stuff. I mean, this is about how we can be different. But guess what? It's all tied not to my effort, but to what He's done. It's tied to a person. It's tied to Jesus Christ. Notice what it says again in our passage. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. I act the way I think. I want to change my thinking because I know that I'm blessed in Christ. I want to start living that way. Repeat it after me. In Christ, I am a new creation. So I want us to think for just a few minutes as we close this about some of the old that's going away and some of the new that's coming. So think with me real quickly about the prize inside. Anybody remember Cracker Jacks? Man, as a kid, I used to love Cracker Jacks. I used to love them not because the candy tasted great, but because it always had a prize in the box. I mean, the prize wasn't worth anything, but boy, as a kid, that's what you long for. Well, let me tell you, in Christ, there is a prize. Not only is there the prize of eternal life, but things begin to change when we start changing our thinking. We start changing the way we approach life. When we start living in Christ and recognizing and believing that we are in Him, things can begin to change for us. So think for just a minute about some of the things. This is not an exhaustive list, and we're going to be looking at all kinds of things that it says about us being in Christ. The old says that I'm not worthy, and the new says I am qualified. Part of the prize inside is what the old used to say. You know what? You're too sinful. You're too bad. You're too ugly. You're too this. You're too that. You're too evil. Being in Christ changes things. All those messages that you and I received as children, all those messages that the world has put on us about body image and about this and about that and about the other things, all those things that have influenced us, made us fearful of God, pushed us away from God, made us fearful of even loving and caring for ourselves, all those things that have disqualified us from the world's perspective, God has in fact qualified us. Notice what it says. I've given you the verse here. Listen to what it says. Giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, that He's delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of His love. God's qualified me, not because I deserved it, not because I earned it. He's qualified me because I've placed my faith in Jesus Christ and what He did through His death, burial, resurrection, and ascension. Those are the essentials of getting in Christ. We must understand that we're all sinful. No doubt about it. Let me tell you, in my own, I am disqualified. I am not worthy. I don't deserve to go to heaven. But here's what God did for me. God said, I love you, and I'm going to take care of it. And He sent His Son Jesus to die for my sins. He was dead, and He was buried, and He was raised on the third day. And He was ascended to the Father where He sits now at the right hand of God. And if I will just admit to my sinfulness, if I will believe that He did it for me, if I will commit my life to follow Him, then I can be found in Him at the right hand of the Father even today. See, the world says, I'm unworthy. Here's what God says. I have qualified. Best sermon I preach doesn't qualify for God. If I gave every dollar in my bank account, it wouldn't qualify me for God. But I got to tell you, His love for me qualified me. We call that grace. We call that grace. Here's what grace is. Jesus gave His life for me so He could give His life to me and live His life through me. That's grace. That qualifies me. That changes me. But I've got to change my thinking about it. Because some of us still today disqualify ourselves. Been Christians for years, but we can't turn loose of the past. We don't realize that the past is just that. We need to let it go. We need to move beyond it because the new has come. We are qualified. Second thing we discover, the prize inside. The old says that I'm addicted to sin. The new says I've been set free. Boy, there's something to this. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. There's been this law that's been at work in me. There's been a law that's been at work in you, and it's called the law of sin and death. But here's something happens. When I become in Christ, this new law kicks in, the law of Spirit and life. All of a sudden, I begin to realize Jesus has set me free. Now, here's the problem we face. Our thinking is wrong because what we try to do is when we have those habitual sins, those sins that catch us unaware, those sins that trap us and snare us, those kind of things, we start focusing on the sin and not doing it again. How many of you have focused on the sin and not do it again? You know what happens to you? You end up doing it again. Happens every time because what you focus on is what you do. I don't need to focus on my sin. What I need to do is focus on my Savior. I don't need to be focusing on my sinfulness. I need to be focusing on my Savior because that will lead me. Listen, the consistent application of God's Word over time will bring about the change that I desire. But if you focus on the wrong thing, it will lead you to the wrong results every single time. You know the old thing, don't anybody in the room think about a white polar bear. Don't think about it. And your mind immediately goes to a white polar bear because you can't think about the negative of anything without first thinking of the positive. You can't think about not sinning without first thinking about sinning. Just being honest. You see, our psychology, our personal psychology, has to be saturated with God's theology. And God's theology says, in Christ, the law of the Spirit of life has set me free from the law of sin and death. Look at the person on your right, the person on your left, and say, in Christ, you can be set free. Tell them right now. Hurts, habits, and hang-ups can go away. We can be set free. Third thing we discover, the prize inside. The old says that I'm fatherless. The new says that I am His child. You realize that Adam and Eve, when they were walking in the garden with God, they were like His children. And all of a sudden, sin enters the picture, and they became orphaned, and so did everyone else who's ever been born into this world. We've been orphaned. We've been separated from our Heavenly Father. But God in Christ has provided a way for us to be part of the family. You can almost imagine that prodigal son. We all know the story. You can almost imagine him as he was walking, saying, "You know, Dad, I really messed it all up." And he said, "No, that's not good enough. What am I going to tell him? How am I going to get back into his God? I only got one chance. What am I going to say to him?" And he goes, "Oh, I know. I'll say, Dad, I sinned against you." He says, no, that's still not good enough. Dad, I sinned against God and I sinned against you, and I've hurt you." And he's thinking about all the things he has to do because he sees his father as being this vindictive dad that's going to try to get even, put him in his place. But instead, the young man is seen by the father who was always looking for him. And the father runs to embrace him, showers him with kisses and hugs, brings out the best that he has, wants to give a party in his honor, put a ring on his finger and a robe on his back. I mean, can you imagine how much your Heavenly Father must love you in order to greet you that way? Think about it. All the bad stuff that I've ever done, you know, it's like morally it would be equivalent to me stealing my dad's billfold, taking all of his credit cards, running out, cussing him out as I walked out the door, going and spending all of his money on all kinds of stuff, and then coming back and hoping that he'll accept me again. Listen, that's what we've done. Humanity has run away from God. We have alienated ourselves. Here's the good news. He's reconciled us to himself. All the alienation was on our side. All the reconciliation was on his side. The bringing back, the healing, the forgiveness, that was all from him. It was all from him. We've been claimed that people, but I realize some of us, we grew up and our fathers, we had a toxic relationship with our dads, or our dads were distant and never told us that they loved us, or maybe we didn't have a father at all. Maybe literally we were fatherless. I'm here to tell you that God loves you. According to Psalms, like a father loves the fatherless. He wants to be a father to the fatherless. He wants to care for us and love us in that way. See, the new gives us hope that we can be His child and be part of His family. Last one, D. The old says, "I've got to work hard." The new says, "I've got to abide in Him." Notice what it says in John 15. Great, great passage. "I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. Without me, you can do nothing." Man, if I could just believe that. If I could just get to the place where I could believe that all I have to do is just abide in him. All I have to do is just rest in him. You see, the reality is, it's not the sweat is not to be on my brow. The effort doesn't come from my side. He said it this way, "You can't produce fruit without him." Is anybody like me guilty of trying to produce fruit? Man, I figure if I just pray a little harder, if I just read my Bible a little more. Listen, those things are good, not discouraging, reading your Bible and praying. Those are good things. Encourage you to do that. Just don't expect to produce fruit out of it unless he is a part of it. Unless you're intimately connected to him. This is what it says. You must abide in him. Remain in him. Be connected to him. That's an intimate. The picture image is an intimate. I am the vine. And we're to be those branches connected to the vine. The only way we can do anything is to depend upon what the vine provides. The only way we can do anything is to depend upon what he gives us. See, in Christ, I'm a new creation. Old stuff can be laid aside because everything's becoming new. I have a chance for a reboot. And not just a religious reboot, but an upgrade of the software by changing what I think about him and what I think about myself. Because God wants me to live my life to its fullest potential. And He wants you to live your life to its fullest potential. But it will never happen in your own power, your own energy, your own effort. It only happens as we're intimately connected to Him. In Christ, I am a new creation. Old things have passed away. The past is gone. Everything is becoming new. Now, the one theme in all of this is that we must be in Christ. So the question that we have to ask ourselves is, what does it mean and how do I get in Christ? The question is, how can I get in Him? I want to be a new creation. I want to reboot. I want to upgrade to the software. I want my life to be different. How do I get to that place? What do I do? Well, three things probably should happen. First, you must admit that you're a sinner. You must acknowledge that, you know what, the reality is we don't bring anything to the table. And we must accept Jesus Christ as the sacrifice that God gave to pay the price for our sins. We must accept Christ. Jesus made it clear. He said, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. We must accept Jesus Christ as our personal Savior. You want to be in Christ? There's the beginning place. You must put your faith in Christ. Secondly, you must commit yourself to following. You have to believe that He died for you. That the punishment that He took on the cross wasn't because of anything He did, but it was because of what you did. It was because of what I did. He took the full penalty for humanity's sinfulness on Himself on the cross. And then lastly, you must trust Him to transform you. You've got to trust Him to set you free. You've got to trust Him to change your life. If any man, if any woman is in Christ, here's the good news. He is a new creation. The old is gone. Everything has become new. Say it one more time. In Christ, I am. I am a new creation. Wow. In Christ, I am a new creation. Let's bow together.